thoughts I'd like to share with you. As you know, we have to start off every week by relieving my frustrations for never being interviewed by CNN. And then I'm going to go over with you a system for doing well on IDs, and that's what Amy's putting on the board. And then we'll open it up for general review questions. So here's the philosophical stuff. We have recently been presented with very clear cases in things that have happened in the U.S. of the nonviolent response and the violent response to similar events. In fact, this is the same event. What I'm thinking of is the very arresting response that the Amish community has made in Pennsylvania to the attacks, the terrible attack on their school. And I've sent you by CourseWeb an article about that, because next week we're going to be talking about the three major religious traditions of the West, Christianity, Judaism, Islam, and how each of those has dealt with the issue of violence and nonviolence, which will be very similar. So it's partly topical from that point of view, but partly I'm impressed very much by the response of this community, that their knee-jerk reaction was, don't hate this person. They have actually started a trust fund for his children. Got some chairs over there. Over here. And they are practicing forgiveness and prayer. And that's a part of it is their reaction, and part of it is the world's response to their reaction, or reaction to their response. And it's always very striking to me that when something nonviolent and countercultural in that sense comes along, something that we're not supposed to believe in or approve of, people are woken up by it. So you have people all over the world writing about their response to the event. Duck. Good. And it reminded me of like when Pope John Paul was shot in an assassination attempt by a Turk. He went into the prison where that guy was imprisoned, and he actually sat in the cell with him, shook hands with him. That was photographed, and that became the cover of Time magazine. So here are people going around telling you that violence alone prevails, and it's the only way to go, and that's the way it's always been, and it's the way it's going to be. But you present them with counter instance to that, and they're awakened in a way. They're always overwhelmed by it. Now, in contrast to the response of the Amish community, you may also have read that there's a person in Texas who's going around to classrooms teaching children how to react with violence when an attacker comes into the classroom. Jump on him, swarm him, hit him with pencils, you know, bounce erasers off his head, things like that. And the tragedy of it, you know, this is going to increase the level of terror and anxiety permanently for all those children. So this is actually helping terrorists to do their work, because he's coming into these classrooms and getting them to expect the being terrorized by somebody who loses it because of the pressures of our civilization. So think about those two examples. It kind of demarcates the two ways that we can go toward security, the way of nonviolence and the way of violence. And you might think of that almost as maybe something that you might want to use for a paper or get yourself started, something that you could use, have in the back of your mind for an essay question on Thursday. Okay. The other thing I wanted to mention is that, yes, three years ago, I had a debate with the Eugene anarchists, and I had more or less forgotten about that, but it came up again in a special class I had to do last week. The Eugene anarchists are like other anarchists, except they live in Eugene, and they have created a lot of trouble. They created a lot of trouble for the Seattle protests in 1999, because they believe in violence, because they feel that you should not have any restrictions on your behavior or anything. So their, thank you, Amy. Their argument was that this nonviolence business, Nagler, it's not radical enough and it's not going to get anything done. You need violence to get things done. My argument to them was, you guys claim that you're really, really radical, but I think I'm much more radical than you. So there. No, I'm more radical. Slug, bang. But here's my point. If you really get down to what is the final recourse that our civilization maintains for maintaining order, for operating the economy, for everything, you will see that it would not be too much of an exaggeration to say that our civilization really rests upon violence. Our civilization as we know it now was built upon the power, both upon threat power, built upon the power of violence. And if you don't get rid of that, you guys, I said, are not going deep enough. And they were very impressed because no one had ever told them they weren't radical enough before. But here's this little Berkeley professor saying, no, in fact, you have not gone deep enough in reconstructing our civilization. If you want a new paradigm, the first thing you have to do, not the last thing, the first thing you have to do is say the new paradigm must be based on nonviolence. And wherever it's the present paradigm is based on violence, we have to reorganize it and get it over on this other basis. And so I think I actually won that debate. And that's hard. To win a debate with anarchists, that's not so easy. I also told them that Emma Goldman, famous anarchist from the early 20th century, was slightly related to me by marriage. That helped soften them up a little bit. But the real blow was telling them that they are not radical enough. Unfortunately, they were taping that debate, and they have the tapes and won't give it to us. So the world will never know about my brilliant success with them. But you know about it, and that's a start. Now, but however, I just wanted to encourage you here. You're about to go into this incredible studying grind, and you've already begun it. You have to have this midterm on Thursday. So I wanted to give you some encouragement about the importance of what you're studying. I think there are many people trying to do a change of paradigm from many angles. It's sometimes called the great turning nowadays is our term for it. It has to happen or you won't have a world to grow up in. But I honestly believe, and that's why I spend so much time on this, that unless the change process incorporates nonviolence at a very early level and builds it in to the new paradigm, it will not go deeply enough and we'll just be off of the same old, same old. Okay, thank you for listening. I feel much better. And now we can get started on your immediate issue, which is the midterm. What I want to present you with here today is called, in commercial language, the DACE system. The DACE system for getting through a PAX 164 ID. And when you're going into the exam, you haven't slept much and you're a little nervous, just remember, ace it with DACE. That's, I think, stupid enough and corny enough that it could even fly in the commercial world. But this is the DACE system. And it's partly in order. Here they are, your big acronym. D stands for define. And what I mean by that is very often people get started with an ID and they tell things about the term that they're responding to, but they don't actually define it. So they say, oh, this thing is tremendously important. I'm glad I learned about it. And you can read about it in such and such a book. And nonviolence would be nowhere without it, and yada, da, yada, da. And then either I or Lara or Eli would be screaming and tearing our hair out, which is more dangerous in my case, and saying in the margin, what is it? Tell us what you're defining. Define the darn thing. So here's... okay, let me give you the other three, and then we'll go to the example. A is attribute. That means if your term was invented by someone, tell us who that someone is, even if it's me. The point being that we're still at a very early stage. I just came from a PAX faculty meeting, and we were talking about the same thing there, that we have to, it's difficult to work out a vocabulary for this field because it's so new that people are using the same terms in different ways, different terms in the same ways, or not using any terms at all. So if you wanted to talk about a particular, a concept that was the property or the invention, the discovery of a particular person, very helpful to tell us who that person is. So for example, if you talk about, well, here's a kind of obvious example, okay? If you talk about Naegeler's Law, you don't say this was developed by Johann Galtung. Right? That's why it's called Naegeler's Law. It's important for you to know, especially if it's something that I've come up with, because you might get the impression that it's universally known in the field and used, and it isn't. So then you get to have a semester abroad at Meiji Gokuin, Gakuin or something outside of Tokyo, and you say, well, you know, as Naegeler's Law states, and they say, Naegeler's Law? They say, Kore wa nan desu ka? What the hell is that? So attribute when appropriate. So this is always appropriate and should always be the first thing you do. The attribution may or may not be necessary. C stands for contextualize, and again, that may or may not be necessary. But to give you an example, I might give you a term which is part of a set of terms, and it's very helpful for you to give the rest of the set. Right, so if I were to say person power, you would define what it is. You would you could, in fact, attribute it to me because no one else uses the term. It might be handy for you to know that. I hope by the end of the 21st century, it'll be common parlance and, you know, whatever we have for the way of newspapers in those days, that there'll be the latest person power event was in Milwaukee. But that hasn't happened yet. So attribute it to me. And then you contextualize it by saying person power is part of a set of three domains in which nonviolent power can operate, or violent power for that matter. There is the classical distribution of the state versus people power, which is commonly understood. Well, relatively speaking, it's commonly understood. But there's also person power. And that's very important from the point of view of principled nonviolence, which actually starts from within the human being. Okay, so that's the contextualization. If your item is part of a set, tell us at one point what the rest of the set is. And define the rest of the set too if you have a chance. Kevin? Okay. And then finally, evaluate. That's because some of the things that you might be given to identify will not come from the world of nonviolence, and they will not be obvious. So if you're defining principled nonviolence, you don't have to evaluate its importance from the point of view of nonviolence. But suppose you were defining something from, let's take a really far out example. Suppose I were to give you an idea. I won't. But suppose, you know, I'm really feeling unkind, and I were to give you an idea which was, let's say, quantum inseparability. You would define it, and you wouldn't have to contextualize it because it doesn't matter for our purposes whether it was Richard Feynman or whoever it was. But in the end, you'd want to say, this is important to nonviolence because it breaks up the paradigm of classical science within which it was very difficult to understand how nonviolence could operate. You might go on to say there is a suggestive parallel between quantum inseparability and the mysterious unity on the spiritual level among human beings, which nonviolence proposes. But no one knows how to bridge that gap. And it's just, at this point, it's just intriguing. Okay, so I'm not saying you need to know that about quantum inseparability, but I'm saying if the thing that I ask you is not immediately obvious how it relates to nonviolence, then it's very important for you to say how. So that's the DACE system, folks. It's on sale this week. And if you remember that, it'll really help you to get through an ID successfully. John? Yeah. Always, that's going to be part of the instructions that you'll see on your exam paper, but that is very, very useful. Always give concrete example for something that isn't concrete. And that, in fact, is true on the ID and on the midterms. Yeah, the more you can back up what you're saying by concrete examples, the better off you are. For one simple reason, you may be defining something a little bit wrong or a little bit differently from how we define it. And we may not know what you're talking about, but if you give us an example, then we say, oh, okay, all they did was they're using the term differently. That's fine. Okay? So what I've done here is, and thank you, Amy, for getting it on the board. I sent it out to you on CourseWeb. I wrote an answer to a putative question on, let's say, if you got an ID called integrative power. I wrote this answer, walked into the next room, put on my other hat, came back, and gave myself an A to this answer. So this is an excellent example, if I must say so myself, of how to do an ID. It follows the DACE system very accurately, and it's quite succinct. You just, you know, think before you write something like this. It could be this short. Your ID could be this short. You wouldn't want it to be much shorter. You definitely wouldn't want it to be much longer, because then you wouldn't have time left over for the essay questions, taking a break, and things like that. Okay, so first thing that we want to identify with approval is that you have given the number and the item that you're identifying. Okay, that's very, very helpful for us, because you can get very enthusiastic, tear into it, and we don't really know what it is you're defining. So that's very helpful for us. You're going to have, let's say, probably 12, out of which you'll be asked to choose 10. So you give us these numbers and thing right away. Okay, just mechanical. But then notice that Amy and I started right off with the definition. So let's say this part here, the part of it arises from an act of authenticity or clinging to truth. That part of it is the core definition of this concept. Okay, so that's our D. Everybody can read this well, by the way? Okay. Coined by peace researcher. Actually, I think I said peace
researcher.
Okay. I actually said peace research giant, Kenneth Boulding, just for a little extra credit. I gave myself a little extra credit on that. But this will certainly do. Peace researcher coined by Kenneth Boulding. This is our attribution, right? And of course, it goes on to say where he coined it in his book, Three Faces of Power. That was the last book that he wrote. And then, what's this all about? The other two are, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. What are we talking about there? That's right. That's the contextualization. Wait. Yeah, that's right. So, DAC. Integrative power, by far the least studied in our culture. That's just a little bit of irony, which adds to the enjoyment of the whole thing. But the important part is that it is essentially satyagraha. Now, you could say a little bit more about that if you wanted to, but that's probably enough. Integrative power is a way of looking at how satyagraha works. It draws upon the fact, which is part of the belief system of the principled nonviolence person, that, as it was stated by St. Augustine, all human beings desire integration as far as in them lies. In other words, there is no limit to how close we want to be to one another. And that constitutes an ongoing desire in the consciousness of every person. And when you use integrative power with the result that you come out of an interaction closer to the person or persons that you were opposed to when you went in, at least in your mind they're a lot closer, and probably in their mind also because of mirror neurons, that satisfies this desire for integration, which human beings are usually unaware of in our present culture. But that they are unaware of it does not mean they don't possess it. And so that really explains how integrative power works. And so you're now in a good position to explain to your roommate or your parents who are challenging you about why it's costing so much money to send you to Berkeley, where are you getting out of this? It's an opportunity to explain rationally how nonviolence can actually operate. Okay, so are those four things now pretty clear? We've got our little advertising slogan, so it should be easy to remember it when you go into the midterm. Very good. Okay, let me make one brief announcement, and then we can start reviewing from wherever you feel like you would like to do that, whatever you feel is most useful. We have an important guest speaker coming to the campus on Thursday. His name is M.P. Mattai, and he's speaking at 7. I think it's actually 2 T's, but that's how I saw it in writing recently. 7 p.m. in 166 Barrows. Now, the point is that Mattai is a Gandhian scholar. He teaches at Gandhi University in India. Can you imagine a country that has a Gandhi University in it? And he's an expert on current Gandhian practices and events in India. So he's absolutely perfect for PAX 164B. Now I'm going to try to interview him, depending on whether Jordan knows how to use a video camera or not, and get what he has to say, because we have to have our midterm while he's here. But at 7 p.m. he'll be talking about Gandhi and Gandhian studies in India. And also, in general, there's a lot of lectures and events that are on the IAS website. In fact, the IASTP, International and Area Studies Teaching Programs website, and underneath the university's website. The last item on the left-hand column is events. So if I forget to send you something by CourseWeb and you're really bored, you want to go to another lecture, always be checking that IASTP. But for right now, I'd strongly recommend that you go to hear Mattai. Normally, he would have actually been here in the classroom with us. Okay, people, so where do you want to begin? Yeah, I think we've sort of said enough about the mechanics of the exam, how to study for it. Yeah, Joy. Well, it's okay. The India phase of Gandhi's career, which is, of course, the actual kernel of the whole thing, we did go over it, and we took about 2 weeks on it, I think, and I pulled out the events and what I thought each event was important for. And it would be kind of hard for me standing up here to do that whole thing right now. Your other sources, of course, are you have a chronology in the reader, and you have either Nanda or Fisher. And it should not amount to more than 40 or 50 pages in each of those books, particularly if you have the abridged B.R. Nanda biography, which, as I said, should be available down in Bazaar of India on University Avenue. Uh-huh. Uh-huh. Well, there was overlapping information on a couple of run-throughs because there's a particular point I wanted to make with one or with the other. So I'm leaving it up to you to fold them back in. And I mean, you know best how you learn historical material. Some people, you know, do it by writing it out very chronologically. Others have other systems. But, you know, get together and sketch out. When you get the question is going to say, take either the South Africa phase or the India phase. Give us a quick sketch of what the highlights were from the historical point of view, and tell us what we can learn from each one, or what Gandhi learned from each one, what was significant about each one from the point of view of nonviolence. Now, what that means is, except for the ID part, we're not going to ask you for particular events. So it's up to you to make your own syncretism, your own synopsis of what you think the important events were in Gandhi's career. Five would be a little sketchy. I mean, five would be very convenient for that particular essay. But I bet having six or seven in your mind would, I mean, we all have to know about the epic fast. We have to know about the salt satyagraha. We have to know about Quit India, the really, really major events. One, the fast that I didn't talk about, you know, the Calcutta fast, and Gandhi's response to the partition and the rioting, and so forth. I suppose it would look weird to do a sketch of the Indian phase without mentioning those events, but others that you want to mention, just as long as you know why you're mentioning them. You know, it could be something that maybe, like the Patna surrender, in historical terms is not a big deal, but it did illustrate. What does it illustrate? Alex?
Just Gandhi's willingness to make concessions sometimes when you know it was necessary to keep the
conversation going. I would go a little bit further than not only that he was willing to make concessions, but the darn thing worked. And that's counterintuitive for us. You know, we tend to approach a conflict with the idea of the harder you fight, the more you win. And as I've mentioned, when he was really stuck and he really needed more power, his first reaction, well, maybe not his first reaction, but darn close to it, his nearly first reaction was, what can I give up? And in this case, we're talking about him making a political concession, but there were also personal renunciations that he made to get more power. You know, right after, while you're thinking of your next question, I'll just share this image with you. Right after World War II, when the Allies wanted to experiment with breaking the sound barrier, the only way they could get an airplane moving that fast was to take a jet fighter, which was the fastest thing that they had, and put it into a power dive. In other words, you know, point it at the earth and keep the engine running, and soon it would break the sound barrier. But there was one slight problem. They all crashed. And hitting the earth at, you know, 900 miles an hour made it very hard to collect insurance for those pilots. I don't mean to be sarcastic about it, but it was terribly costly. And they would have these pilots reporting constantly on what they're experiencing in the plane while they're doing this, you know, buffeting, very tail heavy. One pilot figured out that the way to get it out of the dive was actually to reverse the controls and push the stick forward instead of pulling it backward. And it worked. And you can imagine, here you are hurtling toward the earth at 900 miles an hour. You've got like 8 seconds left to save your life. And you've got to push the stick instead of pulling it. Everything in you is screaming, pull up, pull up. But when you pull up, the plane dives faster. For some weird reason, I don't know if it's still true, but in those aircraft, when you broke the sound barrier, the direction of the controls reversed. Now, reason I'm mentioning this, as you may be wondering, why is he talking about that? The reason I'm mentioning it is there are frequently areas in nonviolence where you have to be so counterintuitive, you have to go so in the face of your training that it's not unlike what those poor pilots had to do to save those planes. So here's Gandhi. He's faced with a rebellion. And you might think, I'm going to collect as much force as I can and isolate these people and get them over on my side. And his response is, I know, I'll give up. And sure enough, in 2 years later, he's fine. He comes out on top of it anyway. Yeah?
Could you just briefly list again the rules of fasting?
Right, okay, that's a good idea. That I'm not sure that came up here. But yeah, let's list them. Let's see. Just over here. And by this time, I think it'd be nice for us to explain why these are the rules. First of all, just to contextualize this a little bit, lots of people who are trying to discipline themselves, spiritually work with themselves, they go on fasts. And that's not the kind that we're talking about. What we're talking about is the interface between the person fasting, the satyagrahi who has felt that the time has come to use that method, and the people at whom he is directing this gesture. Okay, so we're talking about fasting as a political gesture, just to clarify that. Okay, and there are five rules, no particular order. John? Do you want to say all of them? Okay, sure. And we're listening very carefully. Go ahead. You have to be the right person. Now, you're not reading this off a sheet.
No, I just wrote them down.
Okay. Okay, good. And, okay, let's get them down first and then talk about
the right audience.
Okay. Right audience is starting to sound Buddhist at this point. You know, right occupation, right? Right audience.
The doable demand.
Okay. Doable demand.
Consistent with the rest of your campaign.
Yeah. Hang on here just a second. I'll just put consistent. And finally,
last resorts.
Okay. That is the list, and that's really good work. It took me years to actually come up with all five every time I announced that I was about to do this. let's talk about them. What does each one actually mean, and why is it important? What does it tell us about the mechanism that's involved here? Now maybe we should let other people talk about it. What does it mean to be the right person? I mean, here you have Gandhi. He goes on a fast in 1942. He gets a telegram from Nehru saying, I'm going to join you. And Nehru gets an immediate telegram back saying, don't. Continue to be the jewel of India, Gandhi said. This is my job. Julia?
Well, in regards to be the right person and the right audience, I really like
take one at a time. Yeah.
So, to be the right person, it implies that you're somebody that lots of people know about, who respect, you know, that you're not just somebody that nobody knows about, that cares about sort of.
Okay. I would put that under two, the right audience. And what Julia is saying is that this is not going to have any meaning if the people whom you're trying to persuade do not care about you. Because you go to somebody and say, ha ha, I won't play with you, and you've never played with them before, and they don't like you in the first place, you know, it's just not, your gesture will be sort of wasted. Yes, Camilla.
Well, I don't know if this is former Jew as well, but I just remember the story that you told us about, like, the prisoners. Inside.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah, and so they've got to, you know, try and resist their being in prison, and they died.
They died, yeah. This is a frequent outcome of doing nonviolence wrongly. Actually, I quoted those prisoners because they got all five rules wrong. They were totally wrong. They could not have been worse off. But what do I mean by right person? Yeah. Very good. Jennifer is saying you have to know why you're doing this and know that you can do it. What we're talking about here is a serious fast, like an open-ended fast unto death is our classic case here. There are others where you say, I'm not going to partake in food for 5 days just to show you that something is wrong here. But this is a fast in which the other party actually has to respond or else you're going to die. And that's the difference between an open-ended fast unto death and immolation. Okay, we didn't mention that before. It's just in the context of it, this is an interesting thing to note. If you go and set yourself on fire, the other person has nothing to do with it. They cannot interfere. They didn't even know you were doing it until it's over. So you are actually taking your life. Here you're not taking your life, you are offering it. You are putting your life in the hands of another person. Now, part of being the right person means, and incidentally, it may not be necessary for me to say this, but I sincerely hope that this never comes up for any of us, right? I hope we have a long, healthy, active, nonviolent career and never have to do anything so drastic. But if we don't get involved in the deteriorating spirals of violence soon enough, it's just good to know that this has a dynamic that works. So be the right person means that you actually have control over your life force in some way, and you are actually, you know what you're doing and you're willing to lay down your life. Now, people can get swept up by enthusiasm. Next semester we're going to call this the effervescence of the crowd. You can get swept up by enthusiasm and do drastic things which really are not in your willpower, it's the crowd volatility that makes you do that. In the ancient world, I'm giving you, actually this is going to be a pretty drastic example if you're sensitive nature or vegetarian, hold on to your seats here, but I remember when I was the chairman of religious studies attending a lecture by someone who talked about the cult of Cybele in the ancient Roman Empire. Priests of Cybele used to get themselves intoxicated and work themselves up into a frenzy and castrate themselves and give the thing over to the goddess. And his final comment was, now that's commitment. And my comment, which I didn't actually utter because I was the chairman, I was supposed to be polite to our guests, was, no, it's not. That's not commitment, that's hysteria. So people can get tricked into, by external forces, get tricked into risking their life, and at the very last second as it's being pulled away from them, they say, oh my God, what have I done? You know, plug me back in, I really didn't want to die, at a very, very deep level. So you really have to have deep control of yourself to do this in a way that'll make it work. That's the, yeah. That's a very interesting proposal. How would this be related to Svadharma? That's a very interesting proposal. I guess I just said that, didn't I? I'm obviously stalling for time here. Yeah, I think it would, your Svadharma would have to be in the area of service. You'd have to be like really pretty advanced in that area to where you feel that the purpose of your life is defined by your value to others. Or else it would not make sense to you to offer your life in the service of others. Now, the reason I'm hesitating a little bit is that in one sense this is human dharma, where, you know, there's the I like to think of Martin Luther King saying, unless you have found a cause for which you are willing to die, you have not found a reason to live. So in a sense, this pertains to everybody, but very few people actually work themselves around to a position of being in that kind of control. That's a really good proposition. Okay, doable demand. We'll comment on that. First of all, what is it? Second of all, why is it important? What does it mean that the what you're demanding that the person respond to in order to get you to go back into the food chain is doable? What do we mean by that? You can give us a counterexample. I thought this was going to be the easiest one of all. Yes, Camilla.
Well,
mm-hmm.
Yeah, something really politically, like,
yeah.
I guess I keep going back to that example because the only thing I can think of right now, but like those people couldn't just like get out of prison, you know, just
uh-huh.
like that. And so there was no point in that path.
Yeah, the people in the Irish Republican Army prisoners in Longcash prison. I don't know. This may be one of the rules that they came close to being okay with, because after all said and done, they were aiming this at Margaret Thatcher. She definitely was the wrong audience for them. She didn't care whether they lived or died. But she could have commuted their sentence in some other way. Let me give you a better example that happened, and that was during the Cold War. I think it was five Americans decided that they were going to go on a hunger strike to get President Eisenhower and Premier Khrushchev to end the Cold War. And it was just hopelessly unrealistic. You know, there's billions of dollars, decades of propaganda, and an enormous machinery geared up to do nothing but have a Cold War. And you can't say, you know, stop or I'm not going to have my three squares a day for however long. So that was unrealistic. However, what is unrealistic and what isn't depends on who you are, how much power you have, and what the audience is. Remember, during the partition, Gandhi goes to Calcutta. People are slaughtering each other in very large numbers every day. It's horrible. It's utterly gruesome. And he goes in there and he just announces that he's staying with Mr. Sohrawardi, who was one of the people who actually started the rioting. And now regretted it. And he said, you guys keep rioting, I die. And I forget how long that took. I think it was 6 days. And the whole city came to a standstill. It was incredible. So his doable demands were much higher than the doable demands of some other people. Incidentally, a little anecdote that I did not share with you, and it's not very well known, it's not publicly known, really. I happen to know about it. During that period, even Gandhi was stretched very thin. You know, the viceroy, Mountbatten, said, whenever our city breaks out into a riot, erupts in rioting, I have two options. I can send a brigade of 50,000 highly trained troops, or I can send one little man who weighs about 102 pounds and doesn't even have any teeth. And they both have the same effect. But that just goes to show you how much more costly it is to use threat power than to use integrated power. It's a very, very good example. But at one point, even Gandhi couldn't be everywhere. And so he's sitting at this meeting, things were very tense, and he called over, I think it was an 18-year-old girl, and he said, I can't go to such and such a village. I need you to go there. Madeline Slade was there, you know, Mira Bain. And she said, no, you can't send her. You're crazy. You know, they're killing people. They're raping people there. You can't send a young girl into that town. And so he called her over and he said, he looked her right in the face and said, I don't believe in death. Do you? She said, no, Babu. He said, very good. Then you go. So that just shows you how intense and how reaching deep into the psyche these things were at that time. Okay, so the doable demand has to be, you know, within reason, something that what you're calling upon the person to do, they can do. Yeah.
Does that have anything to do with non-embarrassment? Like, with the prisoners and Margaret Thatcher, like, it was kind of, like, what they were doing was putting pressure on her to release them, which I guess you could see as selfish, or, like, if she did that, like, maybe publicly she would have lost face or something.
Good point. Yeah, I've never brought these two things together onto the same page, but I don't see why that would not be an example. Usually when we talk about non-embarrassment, in the Gandhian context, it usually means the party that you're trying to have a conversation with, a nonviolent interaction with, is preoccupied. And it's embarrassment in the sense of encumbrance. But I don't see why we couldn't extend it and say, you know, he's actually shaming her. They were trying to put her in a position where she would be shamed one way or the other. That's an interesting juncture. Yeah. And, you know, embarrassing your opponent is something that, in the best of all cases, you never want to do. There are times when you have to use that device, but it's never ideal, and you want to avoid it under all circumstances. In principled nonviolence. Classically, in strategic nonviolence, it doesn't seem to bother them as much. They talk about, here's how you can get people to do this by shame and things like that. We don't want to do that. Above all, never do anything that degrades human dignity. This is like, if in medicine, the first rule, the first Hippocratic regulation is primum non nocere. First of all, don't make things worse, okay? Don't hurt anybody. Then we can talk about maybe curing them. So I would say for nonviolence, similarly, it would be the first rule would be don't do anything that's going to reduce human dignity. Everybody loses in that regard. So you never do that. That's why non-embarrassment comes in. Okay. Consistent with the rest of the campaign, that should be pretty easy to identify, and we can talk about that also a bit. You take somebody who's not fasting today. I think we've exhausted Camilla already. So this may be self-evident, but what does it mean to say that the fast should be consistent? Yeah.
Well, like with those prisoners,
yeah.
They had always been using violence
mm-hmm.
for
mm-hmm.
to accomplish their goals, but when they were in prison, they didn't have the option to
That's
use
right.
violence.
Excellent. Yeah, the Long Cache prisoners had been out there kneecapping people and blowing them up and things like that. And now they're nonviolent. So you're bringing up two things here. One is, and you may not even realize that you're bringing up two things at once. One of them is this would only be strategic nonviolence because it's clear that they would use nonviolence if they could. So this is the nonviolence of the weak. And we're not thrilled by that kind of nonviolence, though it's better than the violence of the weak. The other thing you're bringing up is the person audience kind of thing. They wouldn't believe you if you've been killing them and killing them and killing them, and now you say, well, I'm not going to play with you anymore. It just simply would not have the desired meaning for them. Good. Yeah.
I just have a quick question.
Sure.
About that.
The Pathans?
Yeah, the Pathans became peaceful quite suddenly. And he said that courage is courage. Like, the people who practice violence have courage, and they can move that type of courage to violence rather quickly. How would that be different from the...
Okay, this is a very good question. Why is the courage, the nonviolent courage of the Pathans, which is something that we like, and we say this fits the mold perfectly, you have people who are capable of violence, and then they renounced it. How does that differ from the consistency issue, where you have these IRA people, they were basically terrorists, if that term has any meaning, and then they renounced violence? Why is that inconsistent? Another way of looking at it is, what's the consistency on the part of the Pathans being nonviolent? Good questions. Hold on just a second, Roy. Yeah. Yeah.
That they were just like nonviolent, they had weak
Very good. Mm-hmm. Yeah, his attitude was that there was a certain level of inconsistency, and that the Pakhtuns had now kind of launched themselves into a nonviolent posture because of their leader and him. And as he was always saying to them, this is not enough. This is a great first step, but it's not enough. As opposed to the episode I think I shared with you where someone wrote to him and said, the police came into our village, they were offering indignities to our women, and I didn't even try to defend them, aren't you proud of us? And he said, I hung my head in shame. But that was not even the first step. This was a step, that was a step backwards. Whereas what the Pathans were doing was a step forward, but only one step. You now have to go and live it out as a lifestyle, incorporate it, and so forth. So, okay, we're getting a better definition of this, I think. Let me go back to my last question. What is the consistency of the Pathan, the Khudai Khidmatgars, being nonviolent? How is that consistent with their previous career? On the surface, it's totally inconsistent, right? They used to hide behind a rock and shoot you at the slightest provocation. You probably are too young to have heard the expression, three on a match. You're too young and you don't smoke anyway, so I'm very proud to say this would not mean anything to you. But there used to be this military parlance, they said, never three on a match. It's because if you were in the Northwest frontier and you're standing up doing guard duty and you decide to smoke, so the first soldier lights a match and lights his cigarette, the Pathan, who's been watching you from the hills, sees you. Then you hand the match to the second soldier, he takes aim, and the third soldier, he shoots. So that was what those people were like. But now, why is that consistent with their putting up with incredible beatings and humiliation and death? Yes, Jen? Okay, that's part of it, that their goals were consistent. They were fighting to get rid of the British through violence, and now they're fighting to get rid of them through nonviolence. But even from the point of view of nonviolence, I think you already said it, John, that they were courageous then and they were courageous now. And that's very important. Remember the tamas, rajas, sattva progression. Yeah,
this
well,
is like a rule
from okay, that's item five. Very good. We'll get to that in 1 second. Yeah, very good. But they didn't try fasting first. In fact, they may never have actually gotten to it in their case. I don't know of any example of them doing that. Joy?
And he threatened them with it. I would think that the people that they were harming would be more worthy than that.
Okay. Here's what's happening here. The rule, let's continue to use that vocabulary, the rule in nonviolence about non-embarrassment is not the same thing as don't ever embarrass anyone. It has a very specific application. It means that if you have been carrying on a nonviolent interaction with a party, and their attention is distracted by something else, the last thing you want to do is take advantage of them. In fact, you probably want to stop your demands until they're finished with their other conversation, and then you come back. And that worked with brilliant success in South Africa when the British rail workers went on strike. That was the end of the satyagraha. That made it launched it into its final success. In India, the non-embarrassment about World War II didn't work so dramatically, but the principle was still the same. So non-embarrassment does not mean don't ever embarrass anyone, which might or may not be a good idea. Certainly be a bad idea to embarrass me before you get your final grade recorded. But it doesn't just mean that. It has that very specific application. Okay? So were we finished with the consistency piece?
I have one more question going back to the non-embarrassment.
Oh, okay.
So non-embarrassment has to do with not taking advantage of a person in a situation. It doesn't, because obviously if you're standing still and a person comes and attacks you and then comes with the realization that it's wrong, they've obviously, there's obviously like an awkward moment that and they feel embarrassed by the fact that they attacked you.
In a way, in nonviolence, what you're always trying to do is some good creative embarrassment. You're taking people who are morally obtuse. They do not understand that they're hurting you, or rather, they understand that they're hurting you, but they don't understand that it matters. And it's true, in order to get them to have that realization, you have to pass through a brief phase of embarrassment, embarrassing them. But what makes it okay is that you're always giving them something to do about it. You're not leading them into from embarrassment into a guilt trip and then walking out on them. I really like this example. When I was in Atlanta, Georgia, a number of years ago, and I think it was some number of white people had burned down a black church, and they were on trial, and the judge ordered them to rebuild the church. And we haven't talked about it, but there's this whole institution of truth and reconciliation. There's probably about 8 or 9 countries in the world where this is going on in an intense post-conflict situation ranging from Rwanda to some others that are not that serious. And the people who have committed these crimes, they have to pass through a phase of awareness that what they did was wrong. And all criminal justice works on this also. In fact, we won't probably get a chance to talk about it very much, but we have this system based on what's called retributive justice. Somebody commits a crime, they've hurt a party within the culture or in the society, you hurt them back, you get retribution, and that's justice. We don't like that. The PNV people don't like that. We want to move it over to what's called restorative justice, where when they've hurt somebody, they have to be restored, they have to be brought back into the community, they have to be healed. Even in restorative justice, though, they have to own what they did. And in fact, the remarkable thing is that most prisoners feel good about that. They don't like being told, oh, you didn't know what you were doing, you were on a drug trip, because what you're telling them is, you're not human. You're not a responsible human being. So there is a phase, but it should be transitional, where they have to take responsibility, they have to own it, they have to feel bad about what they did, or they'll never get out of it. So again, that's a good reason not to push the concept of non-embarrassment into wider and wider circles. Okay, non-humiliation is probably a rule that we would want to follow. You never want to humiliate, you never want to decrease human dignity. But there is a situation, a critical point in which you want people to wake up and realize what they did was wrong. The way to do that safely is to give them some way of getting out of it, some restoration. So that was a great discussion. Where are we now with fasting? I think we've pretty much covered consistent that there's a larger principle, I guess, that I didn't mention, which is that this particular rule applies throughout to nonviolence. You cannot use nonviolence provisionally and expect it to be very effective. Okay, that's why one of the definitions of principled nonviolence, it's not usually the one that I use, or at least not first, but one of the definitions you'll often encounter, if you encounter anything often in the world of nonviolence, is that it's a lifestyle, it's not just a technique. Okay, so now let's move on to the last resort. And I guess it's obvious what that means, that let's say you have a mild conflict with somebody. You don't send them an email saying, oh, and by the way, I'm not going to eat until you keep your dog quiet or something like that. So we know what it means to say that, yeah, why should it be the last resort? Okay, hold on to the different question. Let's even get this answer first. Why should fasting be the last resort? Yeah, Julia?
Because you could take it all the way to death and
it's definitely going to be the last resort. If you die, that's for sure. But
yeah,
what else?
Well, just that it's such a grave.
Yeah. Yeah, and again, this is applicable to every mechanism in nonviolence, that it has a time and a place within the conversation that you're carrying on with your opponent. Yeah.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Fasting, because of the time limit on someone's life,
yeah,
tends to be coercive.
Yeah. It's very... Very good point. It's very clear that the reason for all of these rules is to keep us out of the coercive arena and have it be persuasive. You want to awaken the person, not force them. And about 2-3 times out of 12, Gandhi felt that his fast had not worked, even though the people did exactly what he wanted them to do. And the reason he felt they were failures was that they were coercive, not persuasive. Yeah, obviously, this is a drastic move. You're saying to somebody on this very deep symbolic level, I'm not going to live on the same planet with you unless you wake up and realize what you've done. You know, this is so serious. If my Harijans are not going to be able to be part of the same political community as the rest of us, I don't want to live in that India. I was struck by the number of people. Now, here's a person that I hope you never heard of. His name was Garrett Hardin. He was a biologist down at San Diego, and it was he who came up with the lifeboat ethics idea at the time when it looked like lots of people were going to starve because there wasn't enough food to go around. Now we know that lots of people starve because other people won't let them have any of their food or their resources. But this was the early 80s, and it was thought that there's only so much food on the planet. He was still going off this Malthusian doctrine, and he said, we need a triage. We need to say, okay, there's some societies which are okay, they have enough food, let them live. There are some societies which are marginal, we have to help them, we have to get more food to them. And there are some societies which are beyond help, there isn't enough food to save them, so I'm sorry, folks, they're going to have to be chucked out of the lifeboat, and we're going to have to watch them starve. So that was lifeboat ethics. And I was very impressed by the number of people who wrote to Garrett Hardin or wrote op-eds and said, by the way, please put me in the third category. I don't want to live in a planet where we say this to our fellow human beings. Trying desperately to remember why I mentioned that right now. Oh, yeah, it was the last resort because fasting, especially an unlimited fast, which might take your life, is extremely drastic. You're saying, I'm breaking community with you because the community you've created is unacceptable to me. I don't even want to live in it. So one of the most common mistakes in peace movements today, I'd say there are two very, very common mistakes. One of them is to do things that are symbolic instead of real, and the second is to get the timing wrong and go to something drastic before they've even given the opponent a chance to respond. So that is the point, is that you always want to evoke, to elicit a response willingly from your opponent, not to corral them and give them a situation where they have no choice. Yeah?
I was wondering if you could go on to another ID.
Sure, I think we're ready for another ID. And we'll take yours next.
Fruits of action?
Sorry, which one?
Fruits of action. It's on the second column.
Uh-huh. Fruits of action. I'm sorry, I didn't quite. Yeah, right. Okay, good. What was I talking about there, and what's it doing here? Yeah, huh? Palam, yeah.
Which is, it comes from the Gita about not acting to receive the fruits, but the longing of the fruits.
Okay, very good. Now, if you were actually answering this on an ID, which may not be so theoretical after all. And remember, our DACE system, define what's meant by that term pelem. What's the fruit of action in the sense that this is what you should avoid being motivated by? Remember, I'm not saying you should avoid getting rewards. You should avoid being motivated by them. How would you define fruits in this sense? You want to try? Well, let's not bring in the whole need thing of the whole Gandhian economics. So you could bring it in, and it is interesting, but let's keep it a little bit focused. Sid?
Isn't it about doing action that is right, and you're doing it because it's the right thing to do in that situation, and so you're not thinking about...
Again, that's also true. That's also true that the definition of principled nonviolence, and this is much more general, the definition of principled nonviolence is you're doing it because you think it's the right thing to do, not because you think it's going to succeed, though you believe that it will have a good effect. So that links those two things together very nicely. All right.
It's the specific
personal gain. Right. And I want to go a tiny little step further. It's not just personal gain, but it's restricted to you personally. That's where you go off the rails. For example, Gandhi strives for the liberation of India. Now, does he benefit from living in a free India? Of course. I mean, in his case, not for very long. But, you know, he has children and grandchildren who grow up in a free India. So that's a personal benefit. Then there's nothing wrong with that because it's not only a personal benefit. It benefits everyone. So it's not like the old idea of altruism, which states that no pain, no gain. You know, if you're not suffering, somebody else isn't benefiting. It's not like that. But it's that you are not driven by a reward which will accrue only to yourself. That's the real poison in the poem concept. Yeah, as all human beings normally do. Now, of course, there's a little bit broader than that because in an Indian family, you're doing it for your whole family. You're not doing it for yourself. The decision probably wasn't even his. They told him to go and do that to rescue the family. So it's a little bit broader than the individual. But yeah, like most human beings, he wanted a career, family, you know, things that pertained pretty much only to himself. This can get subtle. Hold on, I'll get to you in a second. This can get subtle because even if you are doing something that benefits everyone, liberating India, it's good for Britain, it's good for India, it's good for the whole world, but you come out with this little smirk. You're saying to yourself, I should get the Nobel Prize for this. This was a big one. To that extent, you're putting onto it a little personal gain. And to the extent that you let that drive you, you are adulterating the act. Yeah?
I was just wondering, are glam fruits of action, is that the same?
Yeah. That's, in fact, the reason I use the word fruit is that's what pulum means. The accent is on the first syllable, pulum. Yeah, Jenny. I think it's pretty big to take a nonviolence course. That impresses me.
And so, what would that be kind of as?
Well, yeah. I mean, you remember that the whole problem is one of intention, not of results. So the issue would be, why are you getting this education? Because you want to earn six-figure salaries someday, in which case you're in the wrong course, or because you want to develop your gifts for the benefit of the world, or you might be a normal human being, in which case there'd be a slight mixture of the two. But I would imagine that in the case of most of you, it's much more the latter than the former. So it's perfectly okay to be a student. In fact, on more than one occasion, students came to Gandhi and said, we're not going to go to school. We're going to join you. And he said, nope, you're not going to join me. You're going to go back to school. When times really got critical, he enlisted students. But don't forget, you are training yourself to make a tremendous contribution to the world. And I think you should feel really good about it, and don't worry about the fact that you're not doing anything yet. In a way, I'm happy when in the spring, usually it's in the spring, in the way I'm kind of happy when some of the students from this class go out and get arrested. But in a way, I don't mind if they don't. We're training ourselves for even bigger things. Yeah.
Can you go over quickly what it means to be a Mahatma and what Gandhi?
Right. The etymology of the word is easy enough. It comes from Maha, which you probably already know means big, and Atman, which means self in various senses. Or sometimes in this connection, we translate it as soul. So it just means a huge person spiritually. And if you remember, some journalist came to Mrs. Gandhi, otherwise known as Kasturba on your list, and said, how many children do you have? And she said, depends who you ask. I have four. My husband has 400 million. So just he cared for the well-being of everybody living in India as deeply and as passionately as she cared for her four natural children. Actually, she was much bigger than that also by that stage, but she was just being modest. But it's that kind of bigness, that's the Maha part, that you are just a tremendous person in your ability to identify with your fellow human beings. Julia? Yeah, those are very important. I guess we didn't quite answer the second part of your question. He started to be called Mahatma shortly after he landed in India. Yeah, and he claimed he did not like the word, but he couldn't help it. Okay. Okay, so the law of suffering and the law of progression. Let's do A first of our DACE formula. Where do these laws come from? Who coined these terms? Yeah. Oh, no. thank you, but no. I can't bite the poem on that one. No, in this case, no. I'm flattered, but no. Who invented these terms? Now, we may only have mentioned it once, so good that I'm discussing it here. If it wasn't me, who was it likely to have been? I'll give you a hint. He was often called Mahatma, although he didn't like the term. Yeah. And actually, these two terms were coined in the course of Satyagraha in South Africa. Although you've only read a little snippet from that book, it'd be good for you to know that it was in the course of the South African struggle that he made these observations. And what were those two observations? Let's take progression first, but let's make sure we get to suffering. Let's state the law of progression. If a body acted upon by a constant force in a frictionless field, what's the law? Sid, did you have a notion what that means?
Okay.
Okay. We'll help you out. Okay. You want to try? Okay. Yes, Zoe.
Yeah.
Very well put. If you stick to your principles, things will accelerate or get bigger, however you want to put it. My colleague, Professor Spiegel, who was here a couple of times and is visiting us from Germany, he was part of an event that took place in Strasbourg where five or six people. He was in prison at the time, and these five or six colleagues of his, they stood outside the prison and said nothing. if you came up to them and say, what are you doing here, they would explain. But there's no sign. They weren't holding placards. They just stood there in front of the prison. At the same time that they were doing that, there was a huge demonstration in Stuttgart, which is a bigger city. Something like 20,000 people were marching in the streets, waving flags and stuff. The press swarmed over those six people who weren't saying anything in Strasbourg and almost ignored the Stuttgart demonstration, because there was something about it which was more right, was more right on. So because of the law of progression, you don't worry about numbers. And that's critical for person power, right? The law of progression states if you, no matter how few you are, even one, if you stick to your principles, when you need numbers, they will be there. Like the salt march that Gandhi undertakes, you know, it starts out with 70 people. 12 days later, he has something like 70,000. Okay, on to everybody's favorite now, the law of suffering, attributed to Gandhi in Satyagraha in South Africa. What does it state? What else of interest can we say about it? Zoe?
There comes a time when dehumanization becomes so large that you improve your willingness to suffer and offer yourself.
Yeah.
Naturally, you restore or you rehumanize.
Right. Very good. It comes in when dehumanization is so serious, so severe, that ordinary communication is not working anymore. And you remember Gandhi had a pretty easy formula for describing what this is about. There come times when you can no longer appeal to the head and you have to appeal to the heart. And to waken up the heart, dialogue and language are not appropriate. They're not even relevant. You have to act, and the most effective action often is to take on some of the suffering that's inherent in the situation. When you do that, you awaken the opponent. We're not standing here and saying it will always work right in that time frame, but it will have an effect. Of that, we're absolutely certain. Yeah?
I had a question about the vows that Gandhi talked about in the book.
Yeah.
And I was wondering if they appeal only to India, like the situation in India, or
Yes.
Yeah, I asked you the email yesterday.
Thanks for that email.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. Especially like the vows of poverty and
yeah.
Some other things. Do they apply only to India? I would say partly. They applied, the poverty part of it applied to India in a special way because there was so much poverty in India that in order to identify with the poor, he had to live like them. But there's a level at which it would apply anywhere. And that is what I was saying before, where if you really needed power, you give up something. And there any if you renounce something in the right spirit, it will give you more capacity. And that's true everywhere. But where we would do that in this country, where you have all of this abundance floating around and clogging up the garbage dumps and polluting the rivers, poverty here is rather differently structured than it was in India. We might go about it differently in terms of a social act. But in terms of a personal renunciation, it would always have the same effect. Yeah, good question. Yeah, I would say the law of suffering doesn't necessarily mean you expose yourself to physical pain. It could be just a risk. It could be just an inconvenience. Okay. So if anyone wants to have a copy of this deathless prose here, I have copies of it, and I think I have one or two copies left of the ID sheets. There you go. In fact, oh, no, that was at home. Sorry about that.
I lost all my
Oh, dear. Do you want to announce it?